We begin tonight with breaking news in the Russia investigation. It's a CNN exclusive, and it could be very big indeed. The question is how big. The story concerns Michael Cohen, President Trump, and a potentially impeachable offense. That big. CNN's Evan Perez, Gloria Borger, and Pamela Brown did the reporting. Evan and Gloria join us right now. All right, Gloria, if you can just kind of explain what you're hearing, what you've learned.
Well, we're reporting that Michael Cohen, who, as you know, is now a star witness for Robert Mueller, used to be the president's fixer, was under the impression early on, right after the sort of Stormy Daniels saga, that if he stayed on message and continued to protect the president, that either a pardon or some kind of protection would be in the offing for him. Our reporting shows that he got this impression not long after the Stormy Daniels case broke. Remember, he went to Mar-a-Lago. He met with the president at that time. We are unclear about who exactly conveyed that message to Michael Cohen, but we know that he came away early on feeling, okay, I'm in a good spot. I'm going to be protected. And we then know that everything kind of fell apart after the raid on his office. At first, the president was still supportive of him. But then he went on Fox and Friends, and the president said, well, he only did a little bit of legal work for me. And then Michael Cohen knew that he would no longer have the president at his back.
Evan, what's the response been from the president's legal team?
Well, Anderson, Rudy Giuliani told Pamela Brown this tonight, the president of the United States never indicated anything to Michael or anyone else about getting a pardon. The pardons are off the table, he said, but it's not a limitation on his power in the future to pardon in any case. So a little bit of a mixed message there from Rudy Giuliani, as often happens. In one sentence, he's saying pardons are off the table, but the president still has that ultimate power to pardon anyone he wants. And he's right, by the way. The president's power is absolute. And that's the key here for this story. The idea that Michael Cohen, for whatever reason, perhaps after he came back from his Mar-a-Lago trip or from outreach from people close to the president, believed that he was being promised something in return for staying on message is a very big deal for this investigation, because if this is something that he is telling to prosecutors, to investigators, you can see that this could end up being part of the Mueller report. And then, of course, this is something that members of Congress will want to know about as they decide what to do about this come next year.
Yeah, I mean, we don't know for a fact, Anderson, that he has said this to Mueller. But if he did, it would be part of any obstruction investigation. If somebody says to you, you know, you take care of me and I'll take care of you.
But again, I just want to kind of drill down on sort of what is not known, because that's as important, frankly, as what is known about this. It is not known whether Michael Cohen talked about this with Robert Mueller. Hard to believe in 70 hours of testimony in front of Mueller or discussions with Mueller, he wouldn't have mentioned this. But it's not known if he is alleging that it was the president who directly indicated to him, you know, I'll take care of you, meaning a pardon or some other form of taking care of, or if it was somebody around the president, again, according just to Michael Cohen.
Exactly. I mean, I think we know from our reporting, and Evan can weigh in on this, that the message was sent.
Right.
We do not know who sent it directly or indirectly, and that includes the president. We just don't know.
And keep in mind,
Evan, based on go ahead, Evan.
I'm sorry. Part of what was happening at the time, if you remember, early on, Michael Cohen's legal fees were being paid for by the Trump organization, and by the so that's one of the things that was happening at the time that gave him this impression, perhaps, that the president had his back and that he was going to be taken care of.
Evan, do we know after the raid, as Gloria mentioned? Initially, the president in public statement said nice things about Michael Cohen. Later on, then, I think it was maybe days later, I'm not sure the exact timeline, he started to distance himself, saying, well, you know, Michael didn't do a lot of work for me. He was sort of a minor player, things like that. Is it clear if there was continued contact between someone from the president's team or someone around the president to Michael Cohen?
Well, we don't know who might have been reaching out exactly and whether anybody from the president's legal team might have been involved in any of this. What we do know is that Michael Cohen has this impression that from his outreach, from whatever he was doing at the time, that the president had his back. And keep in mind, Anderson, that after the raid, and as you mentioned, the president starts distancing himself, there's also a National Enquirer story gets published that talks about some of Michael Cohen's so-called secrets. Again, from Michael Cohen, we reported this at the time, that to Michael Cohen, this was a signal he was seeing, he believed, that there was an effort by the president and people close to him to try to distance themselves from him, and that essentially he was going to be on his own. He started getting the message that for all of the reassurances he was getting, things were going to be different. And he was also hearing from his own family, by the way, that he had to take care of them. If he was going to go to prison, this was going to be something that they were going to have to bear. So all of those things were factors into Michael Cohen's thinking as time went on.
And Gloria, I mean, this is certainly, it's a fascinating story. The proof, of course, we don't know if there is any actual proof other than something Michael Cohen may have said to Mueller, but whether there's, Michael Cohen has recorded things in the past, but we have no idea if there's any kind of documentation of any of this. But it's certainly, for a guy who once said he would take a bullet for the president, this is yet another kind of remarkable chapter in the dissolving of their prior relationship.
Yeah, it's absolutely Shakespearean. The guy who was the president's major protector has now turned into Brutus, right? And at least the president would seem to think so. And the relationship, it's had its ups and downs, obviously, over the years. And you talk to people about their relationship, and they will give you varying stories about how actually close they were. But one thing we do know about Michael Cohen is that publicly, nobody was more loyal to Donald Trump throughout the campaign, for example. And even at the beginning of the Stormy Daniels saga, as we all know, he was really protecting the president here and himself, I might add. But it has all completely dissolved. And once Michael Cohen, according to our sources, felt that he was going to be left out in the cold, he decided that he had to start protecting his family and himself.
Yeah. The thing about the way, though, that Michael Cohen, you said there was nobody who was more, demonstrably effusive about Donald Trump. That's certainly the case during the campaign, almost to a ludicrous extent. I mean, saying like he's never made a mistake before. He's the smartest person. He has the best memory. I mean, all these things, which to Donald Trump's point that Michael Cohen is a liar, Michael Cohen has not done himself any favors in the public statements that he has made back when he was supporting Donald Trump.
Right, exactly. And you can see, from the documents that were released this week as part of this plea agreement with the Mueller investigation, they are saying essentially that what Michael Cohen was doing is he was lying to align himself with the false statements that were being told by the campaign, at least according to these court documents. So what Michael Cohen was doing was lying in order to match the lies that were going on elsewhere. So that's the level of loyalty that he had to then-candidate Trump and later President Trump.
Yeah, a lot of lies flying around. Hard to keep it straight. Gloria Borger, thank you. Evan Perez as well. Joining us right now, senior legal analyst Laura Coates and Jeffrey Toobin. Also, Yahoo News chief investigative correspondent Michael Isikoff joins us, co-author of the book Russian Roulette, The Inside Story of Putin's War in America and the Election of Donald Trump, which was a fascinating read. With us as well as CNN political analyst Julia Hirschfeld-Davis, congressional correspondent for The New York Times. Jeff, first of all, just in your opinion, how big a deal is this or could this be?
Well, Gloria and Evan were speaking with great care about what they know and what they don't know. But this raises a huge possibility. And obviously we'll have to see how the evidence plays out. But did Donald Trump promise Michael Cohen that he would take care of him, either in a pardon or some other way, in return for staying loyal in terms of his testimony? Was this a quid pro quo, a pardon for lack of cooperation with these agreements? with these investigations. If that was the case, that to me is the definition of an impeachable offense, because it is an abuse of presidential power. It is very similar to one of the articles of impeachment that the House Judiciary Committee voted against Richard Nixon in 1974. You know, promises of leniency in return for lack of cooperation. That's not what the proof is yet. That's not what our CNN report is yet. But it is certainly suggestive that the evidence might be in that direction, and that would be enormously serious.